It's 2015 at the East End Baptist Tabernacle Church in Bridgeport, Connecticut. Outside, it looks like any other church, with a big cross on the front of the building. But inside, there's Christmas decor hanging on the walls. You know, those big red and green bows. And a man is speaking at the podium.
We're going to thank you and give God praise today. And I want to thank the...
This is from a video posted to social media that same year, from someone sitting in one of the church pews. The video is shaky and blurry at first, and then the speaker comes into focus. It's then former Bridgeport Mayor Joe Ganim. He ran the city from 1991 to 2003.
You gave me the honor of serving as mayor of this great city. And you gave me that honor at a time when the city was bankrupt, with crime and gangs running our neighborhoods and businesses leaving.
Ganim is no stranger to the church. He's made regular appearances over the years. But this day, he says something surprising, something he's never said publicly before.
But then something happened. I made some errors in judgment.
Those errors sent Ganim to prison. A jury convicted him on corruption charges back in 2003. He got more than $500,000 in kickbacks, including things like fine wines, tailored suits, and home improvements, all in exchange for city contracts.
I got involved with wrong things and I broke the law. I breached the trust that so many have placed in me. And for that, for all that we've lost, I'm truly sorry.
Up until this point, Ganim had never publicly apologized. It took him more than a decade to do it. So this was a big deal.
With God's help, I truly believe as much as every saint has a past, that every sinner has a future.
This apology was more than just an I'm sorry.
We sit here today on Emancipation Day.
It was the start of something much bigger.
One of the most remarkable comebacks in the history of Connecticut politics.
I want to say thank you for allowing me a second chance by being here with you today.
That's a definite line of demarcation, I would say, in the story of Joe Ganim, is that public apology.
I actually read over it before his remarks, you know, he gave them.
The wagons were circling. It looked like Joe Ganim was going to run in 2015.
From Connecticut Public, I'm Bria Lloyd.
And I'm Kate Salter.
This is In Absentia, a podcast about political dysfunction in Bridgeport, Connecticut.
The systems that enable it.
And what this all means for the residents who wonder if their vote even matters.
Last episode, we heard from people who knew Ganim as a political rising star and then watched everything fall apart.
We had heard things that was going on as an elected official. I was a state representative then, and I was the first one to call for him to resign.
You know, I told some people, I'm not going to be part of this anymore. So I walked away from it. The government was on my phone at the time.
In this episode, I'm going to the East End of Bridgeport, where Ganim planted the seeds for his political comeback after leaving prison in 2010.
South end, you have University of Bridgeport.
Reverend Charlie Stallworth is a fixture in Bridgeport's East End neighborhood. He's the pastor at East End Baptist Tabernacle Church and knows the area well.
How are you?
And its residents, too.
Good.
Back in August, I took a walk with Reverend Stallworth along the street the church sits on, Central Avenue. This neighborhood is one of the most impoverished in the city.
So the East End, predominantly African-American, East Side, predominantly Hispanic. You got the North End, which is kind of retirement, older community.
Stallworth's church is a pillar of the East End. He's originally from Alabama, but moved to Bridgeport to practice ministry at the church in 2005. He's tall and friendly, with a big, bright smile and an infectious laugh. Not only is he a pastor, but he's also dabbled in politics. He was a Connecticut state representative for more than a decade and was recently elected town clerk of Bridgeport. Stallworth says the East End is an important neighborhood for local politicians. And voting data shows people here come out to vote for Ganim.
So you cannot win a city election in Bridgeport if you don't carry a majority of the East End.
Even though this neighborhood gets attention during elections, some residents feel there hasn't been enough investment in it. There's not many grocery stores. There's no post office. Stallworth says it's also a dumping ground.
I probably was a person who dumped that does not live here.
He says people come here and drop off their trash in the streets. I see a vacuum. I see a toilet. Is that a toilet? I guess what I also don't understand either is there are places to dump things, like appropriate places. I don't know why people can't take it there.
It's free. It's free. It's free. It's probably dumped at, I don't know, 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning or something. And whoever's doing it has gotten away with it, obviously, before.
I know you mentioned, too, before that sometimes this happens with mattresses or just a variety of stuff. And it seems like the East End is really, like, the main place that this happens.
Yes. You're not going to find this happening in Black Rock. No.
Black Rock is the most expensive neighborhood in Bridgeport. Ganim has owned property there. The first time I went to Black Rock, I was stunned by the big, beautiful homes and waterfront views. In the East End, the homes are more modest, but there's a strong sense of community. On our walk, Stallworth and I chat with Fred. He says he's lived in Bridgeport for more than 60 years.
How has the city changed since you've been here?
Changed a heck of a lot. Very a lot. All this here used to be, used to have a restaurant there. Used to have another place that dip and sip. Used to have a cleaner's, have a bakery, a bank. Used to be a little corner store there. I was Fred. Yeah, it's changed a lot. A lot. Real lot. But there have been a lot of stores out here. East End used to be what's happening, you know. It used to be back in the day, you know. But like everybody moved out.
But East End Baptist Tabernacle Church remains as a place of worship and community.
Let us share together. Our vision is to use innovative tools of
this church in this neighborhood are important to the story of Joe Ganim.
Generationally, racially, and culturally.
He spent a lot of time there in the 90s, long before Stallworth came to town.
I mean, you could go back and look at some pictures of when he first, like a little kid, almost in the big glasses. But this church was kind of a ground base, almost headquarters for Joe Ganim.
Stallworth says Ganim was one of the few mayors to really pay attention to the East End.
And here we have Mount Trashmore with hardly a fence around it to stop children from playing in it.
One thing people remember is Ganim cleaning up Mount Trashmore. In the 80s and 90s, the massive garbage pile gained national attention. It had debris piled as high as a two-story home.
It burns regularly. And when it burns, the smoke goes into these neighborhoods.
Ganim didn't tell us about this himself. He didn't agree to multiple requests for an interview. But Stallworth tells us people in the East End gave Ganim a lot of credit for cleaning up the neighborhood.
His investment in the East End was apparent. In sidewalks, streetlights, raising the level of consciousness of people. And I think when he came around the second time, people remembered that.
Stallworth jokes that he and Ganim are like an old married couple. Even when they argue, they always find a way to come together at the end of the day. Stallworth remembers meeting Ganim for the first time after Ganim left prison in 2010.
Of course, he got out and kind of laid low for a while. And then he called me and asked if we could meet. And I said, of course. At that time, I was also considering running for mayor. But I recognized that he had name recognition. He had the ability to raise some money. And before I actually kind of met with him, our meeting, he came to church one Sunday. And he came in the door, you would have thought Jesus Jr. walked in. You know, it was such a head clap and applause. So I could sense from that some community.
In 2015, Stallworth gave Ganim a major opportunity to publicly apologize for the first time at his church.
I made some errors in judgment.
You heard some of that apology earlier.
I got involved with wrong things and I broke the law. Yeah.
And of course, some of my colleagues didn't think that was a good idea and didn't appreciate me for it. I actually read over it, his remarks before, you know, he gave them. I gave some of my ideas and suggestions. But I thought it was, I thought it was genuine. I thought it was necessary that he do it somewhere, whether in the Black community, whether that he would do it somewhere.
I breached the trust that so many have placed in me. And for that, and for all that we've lost, I'm truly sorry.
Stallworth says apologizing in this setting meant Ganim didn't have to answer to anyone. If he called a press conference, people would ask questions. But in this church, he was embraced by a community who remembered all the good he had done for them.
That's a definite line of demarcation, I would say, in the story of Joe Ganim. is that public apology that he made at the East End Baptist Church.
Brian Lockhart is a reporter at the Connecticut Post who's been covering Ganim for years. Lockhart says he first heard about the apology because there was a recording of it circling around.
It was newsworthy at the time because, if I'm remembering this correctly, up until that point, he had never admitted any sort of guilt.
Some people say this apology was the start of Ganim's political comeback. Several months later, he'd announce his run for mayor. When you ask people what kind of politician Ganim is, there's usually a similar response.
He's a great retail politician.
A wonderful retail politician.
Retail politician. People who like him, people who don't like him will say that. He's a very good retail politician, meaning he's someone who has an ability to go out, connect with people.
Retail politicians meet with supporters in person. They're always visible and spend time in the community. They shake hands, kiss babies, and know how to work a room. Those retail politician skills would come in handy again. In May 2015, Ganim announced his run for mayor, and his announcement was met with a little skepticism. For some people, it was a jaw-dropping return to public life.
We're hearing from former Bridgeport Mayor Joseph Ganim, who spent 7 years in prison, and now he wants to be the mayor again. He officially filed papers to challenge Mayor Bill Finch.
Lockhart says the reaction to Ganim running was mixed.
Obviously, he felt, and there were people advising him who felt, that he had a chance. Because if he didn't have a chance, why go through it?
Ganim pulled out all the stops for his comeback. He had a documentary film crew follow his campaign, and he even convinced a former FBI agent who worked on his corruption investigation to support him.
One thing he famously did is there was a low-income public housing development in Bridgeport, Trumbull Gardens. And they had a hole in their fence. And so the residents were complaining that that was a security issue. So he and his campaign went over there and they repaired the fence.
When Ganim was running for mayor this time around, fellow Democrat Bill Finch was in office. He was mayor of Bridgeport for 8 years.
There were some high-profile shootings in Bridgeport in 2015. Bill Finch as mayor would show up, but Joe Ganim would show up, almost acting as if he was mayor, consoling people, talking about the need to improve public safety in Bridgeport.
In 2015, Ganim ran against Finch in the Democratic primary. Finch says that experience was pretty surreal.
I mean, imagine yourself, you've gotten your city nationally recognized fighting climate change, you've grown the employment base, you've built 5 or 6 new schools, 2 or 3 new parks, things that never happen, and you're doing this in multiples, right? And balanced budgets, you have all these accomplishments, and then you have to brace yourself to being compared to someone who just served 7 years for stealing from the public. And then the press treats you as equivalents. I wasn't prepared for that.
The Democratic primary was a 3-way race between Ganim, Finch, and a businesswoman, Mary Jane Foster.
The wagons were circling. It looked like Jill Ganim was going to run in 2015. Little did we know he'd been laying the groundwork for well over a year. And I knew that Bill Finch could not beat him. And I thought I had a shot.
Finch's campaign focused on the idea that people convicted of corruption shouldn't be allowed to run for office. But that message didn't resonate with all primary voters.
My name is Cassandra Campbell. I think it's going to be a pretty close race, especially with Ganim and Finch. I just hope that Ganim, when he comes back into office, if he does, that he does what he's supposed to.
Maria Inez Valle, and I am a candidate for city council. I grew up on the east side. I went to school on the east side. And when Joe Ganim was mayor, he made a difference. We make mistakes, and no one is perfect. And I believe that he has learned from what has happened. He's not going to make that mistake again.
Ganim won the Democratic primary election by just over 400 votes, which was surprising. Finch was the incumbent mayor, and he had the full backing of the Democratic Party. That's usually the perfect formula for winning a primary in Bridgeport. Ganim's unlikely comeback drew national headlines, including from NPR.
An ex-convict could be elected mayor when voters in Bridgeport, Connecticut, head to the polls The city's former mayor, Joe Ganim, spent 7 years in a federal prison for corruption. Now he's staging a dramatic comeback.
What the hell is going on in Bridgeport with this Ganim nonsense?
That was a question a lot of people had. But Bridgeport's a heavily Democratic city. So even though there was also a Republican running in the general election, Ganim won by a landslide.
In the truest sense of the word, and it's not a distant or philosophical or religious redemption, it's real and it's human, and it applies to every one of us.
And with his win, Ganim had his ticket back to the mayor's office.
I think in 2015, he and his campaign were savvy enough to know that he was a story. Because of his history in Bridgeport, he was a story.
A story of second chances. Ganim went to prison and came back to office. And some voters saw their own stories reflected in his. That's what I kept hearing at the polls during the 2023 Democratic primary.
Since I've been in Connecticut, he's done a lot for Bridgeport. Like, I'm a convicted felon. I guess because his situation, you know, he was in jail before. He giving us a second chance. Like, I got a job now where I couldn't get a job before.
Me being a felon, I am a very nice citizen. I go to my local churches around here. I do have problems getting jobs because of my background. Yes, I was a knucklehead, not by choice, because I had to survive as growing up and I made small decisions. Now, when I try to get the jobs that are appropriate for my income and my intelligence, I'm not allowed to get them.
In Bridgeport, Ganim isn't alone. He's one of many people in the city looking for a second chance. The incarceration rate in some Bridgeport neighborhoods is more than 4 times higher than the state overall. That's according to data from the group called the Prison Policy Initiative. That idea of second chances hasn't just been a part of Ganim's personal story. It translated into actual policy. When he returned to office, Ganim started the Mayor's Initiative for Reentry Affairs, also known as MIRA. Here he is speaking at a MIRA event about the work the office does.
7 days a week, 24 hours a day, create an opportunity for reentry for everyone. I've tried to do that as mayor.
Ganim isn't the only leader in Bridgeport with the criminal record. In 2005, State Senator Ernie Newton pleaded guilty to corruption charges for taking bribes, using campaign donations to pay his own expenses, and tax evasion. Newton is now the director of the Reentry Welcoming Center in Bridgeport. If you step into his office, you'll learn a lot about him. He has much of his life story framed on the walls.
That's me leaving the halfway house when I was in the halfway house.
He went to prison and was released in 2010.
I'm sure you know I did some time, which was BS. I figured that John Rowland got a year and a day.
John Rowland is a former Republican governor of Connecticut.
But what I forgot was he was white and I'm black. Mm-hmm. So they gave me 60 months, which is 5 years.
To be clear, Rowland's crimes were not the same as Newton's. But Newton's correct that Rowland was sentenced to 1 year and 1 day in prison. Rowland resigned in 2004 while he faced impeachment and a federal corruption investigation. He got a guilty plea deal after he accepted lavish vacations and home renovations from a local contractor who was building a state juvenile prison. Newton was also convicted of campaign fraud, but the state Supreme Court overturned his conviction.
So when I came out, I ran for the Senate, lost. Ran for state rep, lost. In 2017, this plaque here is when I got reelected to the city council. And I never looked back since then.
More recently, Newton pleaded guilty to campaign finance violations, but that didn't end his political career.
Did you feel like with having your past history and your conviction and everything, did that make it harder, you think?
Not really, because 90% of the people that's in my district and that's in Bridgeport either have a son, a daughter, a family member, a husband that's been to prison.
That might be a little bit of hyperbole, but his point is that a lot of people here know someone with a past conviction. For Newton and others, Bridgeport and the people who live there gave them opportunities.
We all make mistakes in life. Joe Ganim went to prison. I went to prison. So people look at it as, well, you got corrupt people representing us. But the people vote. So evidently they believed that, wow, when he was in office, he made a difference.
Newton says both he and Ganim faced a political downfall. But we know that was not for long. They were quick to bounce back. And he says some people really believe in Ganim and the good things that have happened since Ganim returned to office.
I love the city. I love what it's done.
Lenny Grimaldi is one of those Ganim believers. Grimaldi has covered Bridgeport as a journalist and blogger for a few decades. He also worked for Ganim years ago, and Grimaldi was part of the corruption case that sent Ganim to prison. Grimaldi says people have misperceptions of Bridgeport.
People get very, very narrow-minded about what they hear about, you know, the big bad city. Well, the big bad city has a lot to offer, and it puts a lot of people to work.
Grimaldi says projects like the Hartford Healthcare Amphitheater and the Sound on Sound Music Festival are helping to re-energize Bridgeport.
A lot of new restaurants, you know, popping up in downtown Bridgeport that you didn't have 15 or 20 years ago. So downtown Bridgeport is getting a much brighter face.
And Ganim has touted that same message of a brighter future for Bridgeport on the campaign trail.
I've been down and out, but I'm a fighter, and I don't give up.
In 2019, Ganim was up for re-election. But ahead of the mayoral race, he was campaigning for something bigger.
Now I'm running for governor to fix our state's fiscal mess, create jobs, and build a new Connecticut economy.
He spent most of 2018 juggling his local political ambitions with his run for governor. But that didn't go as planned, and he was back to Bridgeport. Brian Lockhart was covering Ganim's 2019 race for mayor for the Connecticut Post. The race had a few hiccups compared to the race 4 years earlier.
State Senator Marilyn Moore emerged as Joe Ganim's major Democratic rival in the primary that year. And she actually came very close.
Marilyn Moore is a Connecticut state senator. She was born and raised in Bridgeport. She loves the city and has lived in four different parts of it. And in 2019, she set her sights on the mayor's office.
My campaign for mayor came out of an interview that I had with WNPR.
We should say WNPR is the station behind this podcast.
We were talking about Bridgeport and where it is and what we need to be. And during the panel, they were talking about, well, who would be a good candidate to run? And the interviewer said, well, why not you?
Moore lost the Democratic primary race that year.
I won at the polls, but when they brought in the absentee ballots, I ended up losing by 200.
She actually lost by 270 votes. But before the absentee ballots were counted, Moore was ahead by a few hundred votes. So it was really close.
And so once again, it was the absentee ballots.
There's a lot of controversy surrounding absentee ballots in Bridgeport, something we'll dive into more next episode. After the election, a group of voters sued. They asked the state judge to order Bridgeport to redo the primary. They claimed the election wasn't fair because political operatives had engaged in absentee ballot misconduct. Moore wasn't a part of the lawsuit, but it was backed by a local nonprofit called Bridgeport Generation Now Votes. Here's something we should mention. One of the co-directors of Bridgeport Generation Now Votes temporarily stepped down from the group to manage Moore's campaign. The voters ultimately lost in court. Moore had no choice but to run as a write-in candidate. But things didn't work out in her favor. Ganim won, and this wouldn't be his last election. In 2023, Ganim decided to run for mayor again, and it was quite the year for him. For the second time, he attempted to get his law license back. The state bar suspended him from practicing law 2 decades ago after he was convicted on corruption charges. Here's his attorney, Suzanne Sutton, during the license hearing.
And the people of Bridgeport, the people who comprise the largest city of our state, the people who were most hurt, most disenfranchised by his misconduct, forgave him. And they elected him as mayor.
His attorney is essentially saying the people of Bridgeport forgave him, so why can't he get his law license back? But some of Ganim's peers took a different view. A committee of lawyers argued that giving Ganim his law license back would send the wrong message to the public and would damage the integrity of the bar. Here's reporter Brian Lockhart from the Connecticut Post.
He was able to wage an astounding comeback, having been convicted of corruption while on the job, while having been mayor, and serving time and then reemerging and coming back to voters and saying, look, reelect me to my old job. That is such a significant accomplishment.
But after the hearing was said and done, the court denied his request and said his law license wouldn't be reinstated. The 2023 mayoral race was still on the horizon.
I do think when he's running is when he often seems the most engaged and energetic. He loves the competitiveness of it. He loves the political battle, the political fight.
Back at East End Baptist Tabernacle Church, Ganim returned on a Sunday in September 2023, 8 years after his apology speech there.
I know, my beard's dyed. You can see that, right? It's really gray. Thank you for the unwavering support that you provided to all of us.
Ganim was speaking at the church 1 week before the Democratic primary.
Vote one more time on September 12th, sometime between 6 and 8 p.m. All you got to do.
It's a race that turned Bridgeport upside down.
Over to the school. We'll be there waving, saying please, and vote as Mary Lee says, top line. You had a nice rhyme to it.
On the next episode of In Absentia, you'll hear more about that race and how it became one of the most confusing elections in the country. This episode was reported and produced by me, Bria Lloyd, and by Cassandra Bassler. Jim Huddadeen is our investigative editor. Meg Dalton and Cassandra Bassler are our editors. The investigative team also includes Kate Seltzer and Ashad Hajilla. Fact-checking by Danya Suleiman. Sound design and mixing by Adrian Lilly. Music in this episode from APM. Additional editing help from Lily Tyson, Erica McIntosh, Robin Doyon Aitken, Vanessa De La Torre, Lucy Napafanchel, Katie Talersky, and Eric Austin. Archival news reporting by WTNH and WMPR. Legal review by Hinkley Allen. Vanessa De La Torre is our chief content officer. To learn more about the podcast, visit ctpublic.org/bpt. I'm Bria Lloyd. In Absentia is a production of Connecticut Public.